positions the hives where they get good solar exposure, preferably south or southeast. Here where I'm at in the woods, I'm doing the best I can to get good morning sun. Comes up right over here. The quicker the hives warm up on marginal days, you know, 50, 55 degree days, the more likely they're able to get out and get some pollen to feed brood. So sunny locations are best. Full sun all day is fine. I generally raise hives about, you know, knee high. This stand is just a little bit low. Most of the stands hit right about my knees. That makes for easy lifting for the bend and lift until they get as tall as the last one we worked with. Also, by getting hives, 16, 20 inches off of the ground, it reduces skunk predation. Skunks are pretty big on eating bees. They come to the front door, they scratch on the front of the hive, the bees come out, they squish them and eat them. They chew up wads of bees, get all the good juicy stuff out and spit out these wads, and you'll find skunk sign in front of your hives. A lot of times I find it by opening a hive and the bees are really aggressive. If the bees are really aggressive and I haven't experienced aggression from that hive, I'll look around the front on the ground, and 9 times out of 10 I find these little pellets of bee parts where the skunks have been working on a hive. So getting your hive up off the ground helps reduce that risk. Skunks are thick, heavy guard hair furred animals. It's hard for a bee to sting them, but they've got a little soft area on their belly. And so if they have to stand up really high to reach that hive, the bees nail that belly and they tend to leave the bees alone. So some of our hive components you might have seen in the previous video. On the bottom we have our bottom board. There's both screened and solid bottoms. I've used both. Screen bottoms provide a lot of ventilation. They also provide an easy way to assess mites. There's a plastic sheet called a sticky board that slides in a channel under here, and as mites drop you can evaluate your mite levels. Then the first box here is our brood chamber. This particular hive is a double brood chamber. Most southern beekeepers tend to run a brood chamber and a super, which is a narrower box like you see here. So here we have a brood chamber and a super, which is more common from the mid-Atlantic south, and then the mid-Atlantic north more people run two deeps or a double deep hive. Now that just allows more room for winter storage. This box, when it's full of honey, could weigh 70, 80 pounds. So that's a more honey stores for a longer winter. In a more moderate latitude, from say Virginia south, a hive body and a super. This is actually an Illinois or medium super. It'll hold about 45, 50 pounds of honey. So here I am at 3,500 feet elevation in North Carolina mountains, so my altitude is similar to a further northerly latitude, so I run a lot of two deep colonies just so they have plenty of resources for winter. But they winter okay with a deep and a super. If I have 40, 45 pounds of honey in the super though, I need to make sure there's a couple frames of honey below come September, October, so they have more than enough to get through the winter. Then another configuration that folks use, this is getting really popular among hobbyists, just due to ease of maintenance and lifting, is three supers. These are three medium supers. In this setup, all the frames can interchange from one box to another. So if you want to move resources around, say this box is largely empty, you can move a couple of honey frames that are on the wall down to this lower box if need be, or rearrange empty frames. There's a whole host of management strategies where having all the boxes the same size is to your advantage. And then the main advantage to an all super situation would be ease on your back for lifting. This full of honey would be about a 45 or 50 pound box versus this one being a 70, 80 pound box. So much easier on the body. Once we get our area for brood, this is what I would leave for the winter configuration. Two deeps, a deep and a super or a triple super situation. We use the queen excluder. Then we have the telescoping top. Underneath the telescoping top, we have on this hive a screen dinner cover. I use screen dinner covers from roughly May through September because it allows the bees to get a lot of ventilation. If bees can move air, they can dry honey faster. And then I move bees to honey locations, and with a screened or ventilated inner cover, I don't have to worry about hives overheating when I close them up to move them. So, but typically in the fall, I'll switch that to a solid inner cover. Looks more like this. And so that just helps helps the cluster. Their heat doesn't escape as easily above the cluster in the winter. Some folks in more northern states will put a layer of insulation on this inner cover for winter. There's a lot of different ways to winter bees. I don't tend to do that, and they winter well. But this is my inner cover from October through March or April. This is an entrance reducer. It's got a large area and a very small one. On a weaker colony, I might place that to where just bees can only enter and exit from the small opening. As you're growing a new nuke or a package out, you're probably going to use an entrance reducer. The larger opening's usually fine. If you have a colony that's in weaker condition and you have lots of strong colonies, especially this time of year as we approach August, there's a dearth, there's very little nectar available. I may reduce entrances just to reduce the chance of other stronger colonies taking advantage of weaker colonies, because bees will rob weaker colonies. Survival of the fittest.